Okay, start the timer. I have exactly 5 minutes to explain how the world's most advanced encryption algorithm works before I have to sell you a subscription to a stock photo website. We're going to be talking about the Advanced Encryption Standard, otherwise known as the Rheindahl algorithm, which is the encryption algorithm used by the NSA, Google, Facebook, and any other organization that doesn't want you stealing their data about how they're stealing your data. It cannot be broken, and brute forcing your way through the algorithm would take the world's most powerful computer longer than the entire universe has existed. How does it work? Well, let's see if I can explain. AES is what's called a block cipher, which means that the first thing that it does is take your message and break it up into blocks that are basically 4 letters by 4 letters. If I'm sending the FBI a very sensitive tip on Facebook Messenger, for example, that message is going to be encrypted 16 characters at a time. I know that putting them in a box like this makes them kind of hard to read, but believe it or not, we're not even done encrypting them. This next step in the encryption process is the most important. If you're gonna try and fail to impress a woman at a bar by explaining the NSA's standard of encryption, this is the part you've gotta get right. We're gonna take the block and add our key to it. This key is basically the password that lets us encrypt and decrypt the text. It'll be a string of letters and numbers that can be one of three different lengths: 128 bits, 192 bits, or 256 bits, depending on whether you want it to take several trillion years to crack, or if you can settle for a measly billion. Now, if you majored in math back in kindergarten, you might have realized that there's a little problem here. Addition is a thing that you do with numbers, not state secrets. So we're going to have to do something a little clever here and combine these strings of text with a function that's the basis for most encryption algorithms, XOR. You see, since we're dealing with computers here, each letter is just 8 binary bits dressed up in a fancy hat. But you can't add those numbers to each other like normal numbers, or you might end up with a 2, and if you have a 2, your computer will have some kind of existential crisis. So instead, you add them by checking if each digit is the same or different one digit at a time. If you have a 1 and a 0, you get 1. If you have a 0 and a 1, you get 1. If you have 2 zeros, you get 0. And if you have 2 ones, you get 0. So just as an example, I'm gonna show you what it looks like when you encrypt a 1-letter-long message with a 1-letter-long password. That's a 0, 0, 1, a whole bunch of zeros, and 1. And voila! Now no one will ever know that I said lowercase q. The cool thing about this is that if you take the resulting encrypted text, in this case it happens to be an exclamation mark, and do the exact same thing with the exact same password, you end up with the text that you started with. So we're gonna go ahead and do this with every character in our block, and we'll end up with an entirely new block of encrypted text. This is already pretty secure, but we're just getting started. Next, we're gonna take everything in our block, convert it to a hexadecimal, and then substitute every single character with a character from this table, the Rheindahl S-Box, not to be confused with the Rheindahl X-Box, which is the worst console that I've ever used. But this table is pretty simple. Basically, if our character is 4F, we'll find 4, find F, and see that we've gotta replace it with 84. I could spend an hour talking about why this box is such a good box, but all you really need to understand is that the numbers in it are laid out so randomly that any patterns that might have been noticeable in the last step will be a lot harder to spot. Now we're gonna take our shiny new letters and shift them around a bit. The second row gets shifted 1 space, the third row gets shifted 2, and the fourth row gets shifted 3. This is called diffusion, and it's important because it gets rid of any statistical relationship that gives you a clue as to what character translates to what. If one character always has the same character appear after it, it might be more likely to be Q and U, for example. But now that the text is all mixed up, those relationships are gonna disappear. For the next step, you're gonna have to pause this video and go learn linear algebra. You can probably knock it out in just a couple of months by taking night classes at your local community college, so go ahead and do that, and then we'll continue. Okay, welcome back to the video. Now that you know linear algebra, the next step is a breeze. You're just gonna take every column in the block and multiply them by this matrix. This is basically also a way of doing diffusion, and it gives us the block that we're gonna take into our final step. So remember all those minutes ago when I talked about adding your key to the unencrypted block of text? Well, I was lying to you, but only because you weren't ready to handle the truth. You see, we didn't actually add the key there. We took the key and split it up into a bunch of different subkeys using an algorithm that I super don't have time to explain. In that first step, we added subkey 0, and now, after all those other steps, we're going to add subkey 1 using the same technique. That's the end of round 1. Good job! We're now about 10% of the way through encrypting 16 letters. Now you're gonna do everything that we just did 10 to 14 more times, depending on the length of the key you're using, and that includes taking those community college classes. And then voila, you have encrypted a block of text. So long as you have the original key, every single step that we took is reversible. You just have to do it backwards, in the right order, to get the text that we started with. But if you don't have the key, the only way you can turn this into this is by, well, guessing the key. You just have to guess approximately this many times. Now stop the timer because it's time to talk about story blocks. If you watch my videos and have any interest in making your own edutaining video essays for YouTube, I can't recommend Storyblocks enough. I use Storyblocks to get these channels off the ground, and I still use them to this day. They give you everything you need to get your channel off the ground. Most stock footage sites charge you for each clip that you use, and it's just not sustainable for someone trying to break into YouTube. Storyblocks, on the other hand, uses an annual subscription model, which gives you unlimited access to everything for less than those other sites charge for a single clip. And in addition to their massive library of footage, your subscription also gets you access to things like sound effects, background music, Adobe After Effects templates, basically everything you need in your creator toolkit to give your channels some serious polish. If you're gonna make any kind of investment in creating any kind of video, Storyblocks is the perfect starting place. Just click the button on screen or head over to storyblocks.com/HAI to sign up, and you'll be supporting HAI while you're at it.